Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the ninth meeting of the Rural Affairs, Islands and Natural Environment Committee in Session 6. Before we begin, can I remind all those members using electronic devices to switch them to silent. Our first item of business this morning is an evidence session on the Good Food Nation Scotland Bill with officials from the Scottish Government, and I welcome to the meeting George Burgess, Deputy Director of Food and Drink, Ashley Cook, Head of Food Policy, James Hamilton, Solicitor, and Tracy McCollin, Head of the Bill Team. I would like to invite George Burgess to make some brief opening remarks. Good morning, George.
Good morning, Convener. Thank you, Committee, for the opportunity to give evidence to you today. Just some very brief opening remarks about the history, how we've got to where we are now. We go right back to 2009 and the Scottish Government publishing Recipe for Success, Scotland's National Food and Drink Policy. That was followed by, in 2014, by a discussion document, Recipe for Success, Scotland's National Food and Drink Policy, becoming a Good Food Nation. So that's the first point where Good Food Nation came into our consciousness. And that set out a new vision for Scotland, that we should be a good food nation where people from every walk of life take pride and pleasure in and benefit from the food they produce, buy, cook, serve and eat each day. So I think that gives a sense of the breadth of this policy. The non-statutory Scottish Food Commission was established in 2015 to provide advice to the Scottish Government on the challenges facing Scotland's food culture, and the Commission's reported in 2017 with recommendations to us. One of the key ones was to provide framework legislation, which this bill now represents. In 2018, the Scottish Government committed to bring forward legislation to underpin the Good Food Nation policy, and the consultation ran from late 2018 through to 2019. As I'm sure members are aware, with the pandemic, we had been seeking to bring forward the bill just as the pandemic struck. That had to be postponed, but now we're bringing forward the bill at the earliest opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We're now going to move to questions, and I'm pleased to understand that, Mr Burgess, you're going to field the questions and direct them to the appropriate officials, so I appreciate that. I'll kick off looking at the pre-legislative consultation. And as you said, the Good Food Nation policy has been developed or been in development since 2009, and when there was a recommendation for a bill and other aspects of food policy. The Scottish Food Commission in 2017 raised certain issues around the bill and the consultation. And one of those was whether the bill would deal with public health, food security, insecurity, provenance, local procurement of food, food waste and food education. Can you tell me how, to what extent those recommendations have been included in the bill, and if not, why not?
I think essentially we are doing exactly what the Food Commission recommended to do. As I said in my opening remarks, the Good Food Nation policy is everything. You might say right from farm to fork, but it's actually pre-farm and post-fork as well. So that would include procurement, it would include education. Looking at the bill itself, and if I can find the right provision, the requirement on the Scottish ministers and then on local authorities and other bodies to produce plans sets out the issues that the Scottish ministers, all those other authorities have to have regard to, and that includes social and economic well-being, the environment, health and economic development. So in that, I think all of the topics, Convener, that you've outlined would be within scope for those plans.
So that's something certainly that our committee will be looking at, and over the period, we've got to look at the process of the bill, but we could be taking evidence on that and making some recommendations. There was also the question of an oversight role for an existing or new public body. Could you let us know how we can hold the Scottish ministers to account to ensure that happens?
Okay, the Scottish Government's consultation in 2018 set out our view, and at that stage we indicated that we didn't consider that a new bespoke oversight body was required. For one thing, this Parliament, this committee, and indeed the other committees in particular subjects, will have a role in scrutinising the Scottish Government. For local authorities, there are existing mechanisms as well. So at that point, we didn't see a particular need for a new body, and indeed the bill does not itself contain a new body. Nevertheless, in the agreement between the Scottish Government and the Scottish Green Party, there is a commitment to reconsider that, and that is what is being done at the moment.
Okay, thank you. And finally for me, the role of the capacity within private businesses, could you tell us to what extent private businesses and their involvement in the Good Food Nation Bill, how is that expected? How will private businesses play their part?
I wonder, Convener, whether you're thinking there was a recommendation from the Food Commission about reporting by private businesses. That's not included in the bill. So the bill that's before the committee looks at the public sector, the Scottish Government, local authorities and other public bodies. Nevertheless, there is other work with the business community on reporting. Indeed, I think there was an announcement at COP yesterday at a certain tier of businesses about reporting on, certainly on climate matters, but obviously that is very relevant to food. We are engaging with businesses on food and drink, and I wonder my colleague Dr. Cook might want to say a little bit, as he's been having some of that engagement most recently.
Sure, I can speak a little bit that we have been discussing with business representative organisations in recent weeks about their bill, about this bill, and about their views and any concerns that they might have on that. So I know they'll want to give their own views to the committee in due course, but they've been providing their feedback to us. We have ongoing consultation with business quite a bit of the time. We have a food sector resilience group only yesterday where we discussed this bill and offered sort of further engagement with any business that has an interest. I should add as well that the bill itself, when we are creating the food plans, there will be a consultation process for businesses and others to feed in on the development of those plans.
Okay, thank you. There was a suggestion in some of the consultation feedback that it maybe shouldn't be referred to as private business, but it should be enterprise. Was there any consideration to include business enterprises on a far bigger scale and on the private sector to be included in this legislation?
As I say, we've taken the approach that the bill is focusing on the public sector. There are limitations on the extent to which this Parliament can impose duties on companies and other business entities. I'm not suggesting that that was a determining factor, but as I've already mentioned, there are other routes through which we can look to companies and their reporting.
Okay, thank you. I'm now going to move on to questions on the purpose, scope and content of the bill. Questions from Mercedes.
Sorry. Thanks. Thanks for coming. The bill seems to be quite narrow in scope, specifically focusing on the Good Food Nation plans. So I was wondering if you could tell us what the thinking behind that was and what you see the practical implications of having such a focused purpose of the bill.
Yes, I think you're right that it is narrow in that it is focusing on the plans and the requirement on the Scottish ministers and the other public bodies to produce those plans and, as I'm sure we'll come on to discuss later, the effect of those plans on those bodies when they're exercising their functions. But I think that's the extent to which it's narrow. The plans themselves need to cover a very broad field. I think I quoted already from the bill, and the requirement to have regard to social and economic well-being, the environment, health and economic development. That is certainly not a narrow scope for the plan. So the bill, in terms of what it does, is very precise. The plans themselves and their implications are broad.
Okay, thank you. I think a lot of people had expected to see a right to food in this bill. Is that something that we can expect to see? And if not, do you know why that decision was taken?
Certainly, yes. The Parliament certainly can expect to see a right to food. That right, though, is not in this bill, and it is not intended that it will be set out in this bill, rather that it will be dealt with as part of the new human rights bill that I think has been set out already in the programme for government. That said, the right to adequate food is very relevant to the bill. The committee will see that in, for instance, section 3, there is a very clear requirement there for the Scottish ministers when preparing their plan to consider those rights to food within a range of international instruments. So those international instruments already set an international obligation that is binding on the UK and the Scottish government and other public bodies. And through this, the plans will, you might say, give life to that right to food. It will set out exactly how the Scottish ministers and the local authorities and health boards are giving effect to that right to food. So the expression of the right to food itself will be in the Human Rights Bill, but at the same time, this bill, the right to food is very relevant, and the plans will help to give effect to that right.
Okay, thank you. I've got supplementaries on that topic from Alistair and then Ariane.
Thank you, Convener. I hope it's not too tangential, but it relates to the point that you made, Mr Burgess, about the fact that the plan will be where much of the policy detail is. And I realise that while you can't maybe speculate too much about what might be in the plan, looking at the bill, I think there is reference to things like relevant authorities. I wonder if you could just elaborate on what those relevant authorities are. Are there authorities referred to when it comes to reporting and so on?
Yes. So if we turn to Section 7 of the bill, and that is the place where we put the requirement on relevant authorities to produce a plan. So the Scottish ministers must produce a plan, the relevant authorities. Now, those relevant authorities are health boards and local authorities as the key bodies. We also have a power there to specify other public authorities. So in time, other public bodies could be identified and added to the list of relevant authorities. But at the outset, it's health boards and local authorities that are included there.
So am I right in reading the bill as not specifically attempting to create a new body for the purpose of administering this bill?
That's correct.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, Ariane.
Thank you, Convener. The bill states that the Good Food Nation plans must set out the main outcomes to be achieved and indicators to assess progress in achieving these outcomes. But it does not set any specific outcomes or targets itself. The Climate Change Act demonstrates that including targets within legislation can stimulate action, embed scrutiny, and accelerate progress. The Scottish Government has already set many relevant targets which the Good Food Nation could incorporate, such as halving childhood obesity, reducing emissions from agriculture by 31% by 2032, and reducing food waste by one-third by 2025. I'm curious as to why existing targets like these were not included in the bill, and would welcome your thoughts on whether there is scope to add such targets before the bill is finalised.
Thank you. Yes, you're correct that what the bill doesn't on its face set out those targets, but it requires the outcomes and indicators and measures to be set out in the plans. If we look back to the work of the Food Commission, and part of the work that was done for them and then by them was looking at the set of indicators. And in recognition of the breadth of food and food policy, it looked at a whole basket of indicators. Many of the issues that you've mentioned around dietary targets, climate change targets, and economic targets as well. So rather than setting out on the face of the bill what might be quite a long list of individual targets, the approach that we've taken is not to set them out in the bill, but to require them to be in the plans themselves.
Just following up. So I've had conversations with Councillor Evanson, President of COSLA, about the importance of clarity of outcome. It's been around other issues, not the Good Food Nation Bill, but I really take that learning from her. And it seems to me that we really need clarity of outcome, and targets could give everybody who's writing those plans that clarity of the direction that we need to go in this Good Food Nation Bill. And also that what I hear from stakeholders is a long held out hope for something that will act as a framework, a guiding framework for the government for future bills that relate to anything to do with our food.
Yes, indeed. Perhaps if I start at the end of that, we see this bill as being exactly that framework. It requires ministers and the other public bodies to set out their plans. It then provides the circumstances where ministers and other public bodies must have regard to those plans. So it does provide, we would suggest, that framework that is required. Picking up on your reference to Councillor Evison's comments, I think clearly what is appropriate for one local authority might be quite different from what is required for another because of the different circumstances of those authorities. There will be obviously some issues that will be in common across all authorities and public bodies. So it might certainly, when we come to the relevant authorities, be less appropriate to try and specify at a national level what are the targets that each local authority must have. But I'm sure that the question of whether targets should be on the face of the bill will be something that the committee will want to consider as it takes evidence from stakeholders.
Thank you.
Thank you. Whilst we understand that legislation is required to necessitate public bodies to produce a plan, legislation is not required for the government to publish a plan. So can you tell us if there's any practical implications with that regard? And does it potentially change the focus of the purpose of the bill?
What the requirement on the Scottish ministers to have a plan. You're right that there is nothing to stop the Scottish ministers from setting out a plan on a non-statutory basis. There are plenty of policies and plans that are set out in that way. Indeed, when it proved impossible to bring forward this bill in early 2020, we had at that stage looked instead to prepare a plan, the plan that would be required by the bill, but to do so on a non-statutory basis. So it is perfectly possible to create a plan on a non-statutory basis. What the bill does, though, is give that plan teeth. So it puts requirements around it in terms of consultation and scrutiny, but then, as I said earlier, creates a legal requirement for ministers to have regard to that plan. And that has consequences for ministers and indeed for the public bodies in relation to their plan. So it goes beyond what would be the case for, an administrative plan, so something that the Scottish ministers simply decide off their own volition to create. It creates the requirement on them to have the plan, and it sets out the effect of that plan.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to move very shortly to questions from Beatrice, but Jim's got a procedural question he'd like to ask.
Something you said earlier on. You'll have to forgive me, George, new MSP, so daft laddie questions here. Finlay mentioned an oversight body, the potential for an oversight body to be set up. Are there not already public bodies that could absorb this in being an oversight body?
There are indeed, and as part of our consideration, further consideration of this issue, that's one of the things that we would be wanting to look at. Obvious candidates might include Food Standards Scotland, so standing apart from government, they of course have very particular duties and functions, so it wouldn't necessarily be, you know, as simple as simply conferring an oversight function on them. There are other bodies as well. The Human Rights Commissioner, in relation to the right to adequate food, would, I'm sure, have views on the adequacies of plans. So there are a number of bodies already that are in this space and would have an interest and would provide oversight. That, as I say, is why, going back to the consultation in 2018-2019, we did not at that stage see that there was a very clear need for a new body. But as I said already, that matter is being reconsidered.
Okay, thank you. Why the bill provides for a negative parliamentary procedure? Why is it a negative parliamentary procedure?
In relation to the various delegated powers, most of them are indeed negative. There is at least one that is affirmative. We've prepared a delegated powers memorandum, which your colleagues in the DPLRC will no doubt be scrutinising and will in due course provide a report to this committee in their views. I think our view was that negative is adequate for most of the powers that are here. I think the one where we have taken or introduced a requirement for affirmative, and my colleagues will keep me right, is in relation to the international instruments. So in section 3, where I think any change to that list is subject to affirmative procedure.
Okay. Thank you. I may come back to that.
Thank you. I'll move on to questions from Beatrice.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, panel. I'm interested in the terminology and the phrase that's used a lot is have regard to. That seems quite subjective and open to interpretation, so I'd like to maybe get a better understanding of what that actually means throughout the bill and when could have regard to become disregard.
Okay, have regard to is a phrase that you will find very frequently appearing in statute. It's a well-worn phrase that the parliamentary draftsman used because it actually encapsulates what we want here. If you think of a sort of spectrum from, you know, completely disregarding or being required to disregard something, and there will be some cases where that is provided in statute, through having a bit of a look at it to being ultimately, you know, completely required to adhere to it with no deviation whatsoever. Have regard is towards the second end of that spectrum, so it requires the body to take it into account, to consider it, and give it proper consideration, not just a, yes, we've looked at it once and that's fine, we don't need to go back to it. It would also require them to be able to justify the approach that they've taken. It doesn't, though, go as far as a slavish requirement to follow what's in the plan. There may well be circumstances, there may well be other duties that the body is subject to that would say that in a particular circumstance, having, you know, an absolute adherence to the plan is not the right approach. But as I say, have regard to is a well used phrase across many statutes. There was a reference earlier to the Climate Change Act, and many of the duties there are duties to have regard to sort of plans or targets or the like.
So bodies would have to demonstrate that they had gone through that process?
states.
Yeah. Thank you. That's helpful.
Thank you. I move on to questions from Jim.
Question one?
Question five.
I'd like to ask, what sort of functions does the bill team expect to be made under Section 4, the Scottish Minister in regard to the National Food Plan when exercising certain functions?
Trish, are you the best person to... Yes, so my colleague Tracy has some examples that might help with this.
Okay, thank you. So the bill sets out that Scottish ministers and relevant authorities need to have regard to the plans whether exercising certain specified functions or a function falling within a specified description. So the specified functions will be set out in secondary legislation, and the specification will be primarily by reference to a subject area. So an example would be the provision of food in schools would be the subject area. But there would also be, the intention is that there could also be a requirement to refer to certain aspects of legislation in relation to that. So, for example, in relation to provision of school and food, you could refer to various parts of the Education Scotland Act in 1980. And the idea is that this is quite a flexible approach that would allow everything to be caught under the description, so you're unlikely to miss things by specifying specific functions, but by describing them, more likely to catch everything that would be of relevance to the plans. And that means that the legislative powers are going to be focused much more closely on the policy areas that are of real relevance to the delivery of the Good Food Nation plans. I have more specific detail on the provision of food in schools and the relation between the description and the references to the Act, if that would be helpful.
It would be, yes.
Okay. It gets quite technical now. So for example, if Scottish ministers were, their Good Food Nation plans could include a reference to responsibilities with regard to providing food in schools, and they could also refer to the Education Scotland Act. So for example, they could refer to sections 53 and 53A of the Act, and these are about the provision of school meals and the promotion of school lunches. So that would be the specific reference in the legislation. But then the description about the wider description would cover things such as looking at the wider responsibilities with regard to the provision of food. So looking at for example, ongoing developments around procurement, you could look at food waste, you could be looking at healthy eating and nutrition for young people, and that would fall under the description, but you could also be looking at specific aspects of the Act. So
include elements of education in that, for want of a better phrase, catch them all system.
Yes, that
it gives scope to say, so if a local authority was trying to avoid doing something, it's still there within. Is that what you're telling me?
No, I think...
I'm not trying to avoid it, just saying we can't do that because of this.
I think these are considerations that would probably already be taken into account when developing food policy, but the difference is that there would now be a statutory requirement to take all these things into consideration. So you wouldn't be focusing on the narrow aspect of just the provision of food in schools, you would be looking at the wider policy environment, and that would give... that in the exercise of those functions, so that would be having regard to the Good Food Nation plan and expanding it from that narrow focus to a much wider focus, and there being a statutory duty to do that.
Just something that's popped into my mind. The World Health Organization have a definition of what a health promoting school is, which does what I think you've just said, it encompasses the environment and everything else. Has that been considered during the process of this putting the bill together?
I'm sorry, I missed the first bit of what you
right,
said
okay.
there.
Yeah. The World Health Organization have a definition of what a health-promoting school is, okay. Which includes the environment, the community in which the school resides, the ability to be able to teach kids about where the food comes from and all the rest of it. Has that been referenced or was that looked at during the build-up of the provision of this, or the making up of this bill?
I'll pass back to George Burgess
on
that one.
Yeah. I think that's the sort of issue that would actually be for the local authorities when they're framing their plan. Take a hypothetical example. A local authority might decide that its policy that it's going to include in the plan is for all of its schools to become health-promoting schools. So at the level of the bill and what we're providing here by way of specified functions, we might be saying that either narrowly in relation to school food functions or more broadly in relation to a wider set of education functions that the local authorities would have to have regard to the plans. What we're trying to achieve here, just maybe to take it back up a level, is a balance. We could say Scottish ministers, local authorities, in all of their functions, have to have regard to the plan. And there are other cases in statute where that approach is taken. The difficulty with that is that there will be lots of functions where really what's in the Good Food Nation plan has little relevance to the function, so we wouldn't want to get into a sort of tick-box exercise of, yes, we've considered this plan, even if it's, we know at the outset that it has very little effect. Rather, we want to make sure that the taking account of the plan, having regard to the plan, is focused on those functions where it really matters and will really make a difference. And that's why the approach that we've got here has been taken, so that we get the plans to bite where they need to.
Thank you.
I'm going to bring Rachel in a second. Can I ask, should Parliament not play a role in deciding what those specific functions are to ensure that the concerns of Parliament are addressed and not leave it to the discretion of government whether those functions that might fall under the requirement of due regard to the Good Food Nation Bill? Is there not a suggestion that there's I know lists are dangerous because it's not what's included in the list often that's important, it's what's not included in the list. But we do have secondary legislation that at some point might address that. But is there not a role for Parliament or the Bill to have some of those specified functions in the Bill at this stage rather than waiting for secondary legislation? And on that, can you tell us when it's likely that secondary legislation would come forward for this? Where I'm coming from is, as a Parliament, we might decide that nutrition in elderly people is very important. And we want that to be a principle of the Good Food Nation Bill and always be referred to when anything comes forward that might have an impact on that. But the government may not suggest it's one of their specified functions. Why is there not an opportunity for those specified functions to be laid out in the primary legislation and potentially added to in the secondary legislation?
Certainly that was one of the approaches that we considered as to whether we would have, if you like, a principal group of functions specified in the bill and others in the secondary legislation. A little like, as is already provided in the bill, the key relevant authorities, so local authorities and health board, are specified on the bill, and then there's a power to supplement it. I think eventually we concluded that it was probably neater to have all of those functions in one place, so in a set of regulations. That said, I sort of take the point about parliamentary scrutiny. The regulations would be subject to sort of parliamentary oversight, but obviously that is at that stage it's take it or leave it. I would expect, however, that we will be consulting on the list of functions, so there will be an opportunity to feed in points. We've been considering the appropriate sort of timescales for this. Certainly, I envisage that the list of functions is actually being developed in parallel with the plan, so that we make sure that the plans and the list of specified functions match up.
Because certainly there is concern that when we come to secondary legislation, as you've suggested, there is a lack of ability for Parliament to scrutinise that, as you say, it's take it or leave it. So that may be an issue. Can I bring in Rachel Hamilton?
Just
a supplemental? Or do you want me to ask my other questions at the same time? Or?
No, if you just take your supplemental just now, thanks.
So, Mr. Burgess, it sounds as though this bill is putting the onus on local authorities. You've mentioned local authorities a lot here to produce this Good Food Nation plan. Have you considered the expertise within local authorities for nutritional experts to be able to produce these reports, and indeed the local supply chains, logistics experts, expertise that they'll need, and all the other things that the government are expecting local authorities to do without a specific budget?
There has certainly been engagement with local authorities and COSLA throughout the development of this, right back to the Food Commission and the consultation, and much more recently. A number of local authorities already have plans very similar to the ones here in place, and they have decided to do so. So there is already expertise in the local authority community. I think there may well be a need for more expertise, and indeed, I would suggest mutual assistance. I mean, this is not, as you will see, something that is simply being visited by government on local authorities and other public bodies. The first sections of the bill are placing that self-same requirement to have a plan on the Scottish ministers ourselves. So this is, the sauce for the goose is sauce for the gander as well.
Can I just drill down into this, because it's really specific to the framework? You're saying that Scottish ministers have a responsibility for local authorities to give them expertise and guidance. So who is actually going to be creating these reports in terms of, and who will have the accountability? And you know, how is that reflected in that stage one of the framework?
The two sets of plans. There's the National Good Food Nation Plan, which the Scottish ministers are required to produce, and the first couple of sections of the bill relate to that plan. Then, from Section 7 onward, we have the requirement on local authorities and health boards to produce their plans. So those will be a matter for the local authorities to produce. They are also in that required to have regard to the National Good Food Nation Plan as well. So that itself will provide some additional guidance for local authorities and the other public bodies when they come to frame their plans. That may sound like a rather top-down approach. I think in practice we envisage this as being a system of mutual aid, that there will be good ideas, great ideas coming up from local authorities and other bodies as to what they would want to see in the national plan. So it's not simply all coming top down.
Then move on to questions from Marianne.
Thank you, Convener. Beyond passing the bill, there's no statutory role for the Scottish Parliament in relation to the National Good Food Nation Plan that you just mentioned. The bill requires the Scottish Government to publish and lay before the Scottish Parliament its Good Food Nation Plan, but it does not make any provisions for ministers to consult the Scottish Parliament on its draft plans to provide for the Parliament or its committees to approve the plan. The bill also does not provide any oversight mechanism in relation to Scottish ministers and public bodies' requirements to produce a Good Food Nation plan or to have regard to it when exercising the specified functions. I'd like to understand why there is this lack of any parliamentary or other oversight in relationship to the National Good Food Nation Plan.
Section 2, I think, sets out the key duties. The first of those is for the Scottish ministers to publish and consult on the draft of the plan and to have regard to any responses to the consultation. We've already discussed what have regard to means in that context and elsewhere in the bill. So it would be perfectly open to this committee or any other committee of the Parliament to contribute at that point to the consultation on the plan, and ministers, according to Section 2, would be required to have regard to those views. There is then, as you've noted, the requirement to report and publish and lay before the Parliament the report every 2 years on the plan. So again, that is providing an opportunity for the Parliament and its committees to look at what the Scottish Government has said and hold the Scottish Government to account.
Thank you for that. And in a previous theme, you were talking about consulting with local authorities on this, and that, you know, local authorities will be writing the plans. Where is the scope for communities to engage with the creation of these local plans?
In both the national requirement on the Scottish ministers and the requirement on the relevant authorities, including local authorities, to consult. So there is a requirement to publish and consult. That consultation requirement is not limited to a certain group of people. We are not saying you can only contribute if you're in this certain class of people or bodies. That is an open consultation, and the requirement to have regard to consultation responses applies to each and every one of those consultation responses. So there will be, ultimately it will be for each local authority to determine what their process is, there will be opportunities, I'm sure, for community, for grassroots engagement, as there has been throughout the work leading up to this point. So the work of the Scottish Food Commission, there was a summit that we held in, as I recall, late 2017, around the preparation of the bill. There's been the public consultation that I've already referred to. So actually there have been opportunities throughout this process, and will be for not just NGOs or statutory organisations to get involved, but for everyone to get involved in the framing of the national and the individual plans.
From your experience, I'm curious, because I hear yesterday about the local governance review and talking to community groups, and the fact that actually some of them didn't even know that it existed. So I'm just curious to know, your thoughts, the Scottish Government's thoughts on what can be done to make sure that people really understand that a plan is being made on their behalf and how they can actually contribute. Because it does seem to me across Scotland, on all the consultations we do, we're not really reaching people who really need to be involved.
Yes, it's always much easier to reach the usual suspects than others that are not traditionally or regularly involved in consultation. So I wouldn't suggest that it's an easy thing. If all that was done was publishing a plan by sticking it on a website, waiting 3 months and seeing what responses came in, I would suggest that's probably an inadequate approach to consultation for something like this, where we need to get to a wide group of stakeholders, the institutional stakeholders, the NGOs, and the general public.
Thank you.
Thank you. I now move to Jenny.
Thank you, convener, and thank you, panel. It's really following on from questions from both Ariane and Rachel with regards to local authorities, health boards and other public organisations. As I think you mentioned, Mr Burgess, some local authorities already have plans in place and one size doesn't fit all. So I'm interested just to ensure, or just to ask, what flexibility does the bill give around public bodies to have to drafting their own Good Food Nation plans? I'm very aware of consistency versus equality.
The bill is not very prescriptive. So we've set out, and if I find the right section, section 7, which is mainly around local authorities and other public bodies. So it's setting out there the requirement on them to have regard to the list we've already touched on several times: social and economic well-being, the environment, health and economic development. There is also the requirement for them to have regard to the national Good Food Nation plan as well. Beyond that, it is really up to the individual bodies to determine what is best in their circumstances. So we're not creating a template for the plans, that it will be open to the local authorities to frame them and develop them in the way that they see best fits their circumstances.
Great, thank you. I'm kind of reading through the bill, and I every so often it's a must, then it's a may, and then it's a have regard. So I think that's very helpful. Thank you. And just one other question. I'm interested to know how the bill will allow for the effectiveness of the public bodies plan to be overseen by the Scottish Government.
So both in relation to the Scottish ministers, where there's a requirement to report and lay before the Scottish Parliament every 2 years the report on the plans, there is then in section 11 for the local authorities and the other bodies a requirement to report on a similar timescale. We are not providing here a requirement for the local authorities to and other bodies to report to the Scottish ministers. We are not putting ourselves in the position of marking their homework. Rather, so long as they follow the requirements here of publishing and their report, we're not putting any further checking by the Scottish ministers of their plans and their progress.
Okay, thank you.
And Karen.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. I'd like to firstly just caveat my question really as into how data has been gathered and used to inform the development of the plan, distinct from consultation on a finalised draft plan. In the spirit of COP, reforming food systems is crucial if we're to hit our targets. In Scotland, the debate centres a lot around what it means to be a good food nation. So, in an international context, can the panel comment on best practice and us learning from other countries as we seek to reform the food system? And as well as we do in terms of pioneering best practice in our own world-beating food and drink sectors, can we example learn from the likes of Italy on food culture, Finland on local food, Brazil on dietary guidelines, just naming a few, who have actually made acknowledged progress changes that we can all learn from?
Okay, so maybe two different aspects of that. First on data. So the bill itself does not itself require data. Nevertheless, the requirements for the national and the individual plans to set out indicators or other measures will, in many cases, be data-driven. So I referred earlier to the work begun by the Scottish Food Commission looking at what might be potential indicators and targets and the availability of data there. So in some cases, the data is readily available, and that's great. In other cases, things that we might really quite like to know, we simply do not have the data, nor would it be really proportionate to try and seek that data. So in those cases, we might need to look to use proxy measures in instead. So this committee's predecessor in scrutinising the agriculture retained EU law and data bill a year or so ago, one of the provisions there was around data collection. Now, that's very much focused on the agri-food element of it, but one of the things that we had in mind there was making sure that we have the powers and the mechanisms to collect data that would be relevant. Turning to the second part of your question around learning from others' experiences, absolutely, that is what we should be doing. It shouldn't be a case of, you know, if it's not made here, it's no good. Our colleagues in Northern Ireland have very recently produced a consultation on a sort of food strategy, and so that will be one of the things that we will be looking at to learn from examples. On the international space, the Food and Agriculture Organization of the United Nations, in relation to the right to adequate food, publishes quite a wide range of material, including case studies from other nations. So I think that will be one of the sources that we will be looking to find good examples. Now, of course, something that works in one country will not necessarily automatically work in another country, but that shouldn't be a reason to dismiss it out of hand without considering it.
Thank you. Can I come in with a supplementary?
Yes, certainly.
Is that okay,
Convener?
Thank you. we're signed up to the international human rights laws protecting the right to food, but the Scottish Human Rights Commission is calling on the government to take action to go a little bit further, so that this bill can be fit for purpose to tackle poverty and health-related inequalities while supporting local economies and industry. How important has it been that people with lived experience of food poverty and access to good food have had input, and what way has that been ensured in the development of the plan?
Okay, I think we talked earlier about the approach to consultation on the plans as they're being developed, and I think what I said there was that, you know, a consultation that is, you know, the very traditional, you know, written consultation, 3 months, that, and, you know, get your written views in, is a good start, but not the sum total of it. If you go back to the work of the Food Commission itself had people from a whole range of different backgrounds, including, importantly, at least one member that was someone that was experiencing food poverty. And speaking very personally, one of the things that made the biggest impression on me attending some of the meetings of that commission was the comments from that person of essentially, yes, you know, all this Good Food Nation stuff is all very well, but as she said, where can I buy a cabbage? You know, if there's great good food, but if I can't physically access it. So, you know, right from the point of the Food Commission, and I would suggest all the way through the development of the plans, we do need to be taking into account, as you say, the lived experience of individuals.
Thank you. On the back of that, you know, the bill requires the Scottish Government to consult on a draft plan, and at the risk of going over ground we've already covered, but there's no obligation to consult in the making up of that plan. And we might have a bill here that includes other topics that are not in the bill as it is at the moment. So surely it would be sensible to consult as part of the initial plan rather than only after a draft plan has been made, given your last response. And also, should there not be an obligation on the public bodies to also consult during the formation of their plan to ensure those stakeholders, those with lived experience, those organisations that represent older people with malnutrition or children in school meals, should that not be part of the bill, an obligation to consult as part of the formation of the plan rather than the draft plan?
I think we could potentially get tied into sort of procedural knots if we start putting in statute requirements at a whole number of stages. I mean, obviously, that would be something that the committee will want to consider. But I think, from what I've said, you know, the success of this will depend on, you know, not government officials like those here, you know, sort of sitting in a building and dreaming up a plan, and then, you know, the first that anyone outside sees is the draft plan being published under the requirements of the bill. Rather, it is going to need to be an inclusive process, including bodies, and as we've already said, you know, that process is underway already, engaging with local authorities, with businesses and others.
Thank you. I'll move to Rachel.
Thanks, Convener. On Finlay's point there about pre-legislative consultation for public bodies, do you maybe think it is a good idea because originally when the consultation was done, things have changed? And if Mr. Burgess, you mentioned procurement through, you know, local authorities, public bodies, procurement was under EU legislation, and therefore there was no... There was no requirement to state the origin, country of origin. So therefore, if we are to create a good piece of legislation which does encourage further public procurement for Scottish produce, and we don't have pre-legislative consultation, how can that be effective?
I think there's a difference between requiring consultation and, you know, the consultation happening. For instance, today our public sector food forum is meeting, so that is bringing together local authorities, those in the sort of colleges and university sector, and others in the sort of wider public sector with an interest in food. Now, that forum has been born out of the pandemic, but we have seen a real value in it, in looking at issues like public procurement. As you said, rightly, we're not bound in quite the same way by the EU rules that previously existed. Most of those are, however, retained EU law, and there are, of course, a number of international obligations, not least the WTO agreement on government procurement. So it is not, and I'm sure you weren't suggesting that it was, it's not a free-for-all in terms of what can be done on procurement. The committee, I'm sure, will be aware that the UK government in particular, DEFRA, is also looking at the moment on developing a food strategy, and this is on the back of the reports from Henry Dimbleby. One of the areas that is flagged up in Henry Dimbleby's reports and in government consideration is around public procurement, and there's already agreement between the Scottish Government, UK Government and our Welsh and Northern Irish counterparts to use our interministerial fora to be looking at those issues, because we'll have the similar issues coming up in all parts of the UK.
You've preempted my next question, because I wanted to ask what joint working there would be with the National Food Strategy and DEFRA. But I suppose building on that, I read that paper last night, and it is very much based on a whole food system rather than quite a narrow kind of description of a good food nation bill. And my question would be, how can, again, this be an effective piece of legislation if we're not looking at it alongside other bits of current legislation and future legislation? So, for example, if we want to have good, resilient local food supply chains and we don't know what the agricultural bill is saying, how can we ensure that farmers are creating food and being given that the policies are being created to allow them to reduce their environmental impact and create good local accessible food for people in local authorities? Because that's not going to happen right across Scotland, because not all farmers are producing food to finish.
I think on part of that I would go back to the discussion that we had earlier about, yes, you might say the bill is narrow, but actually the plans are broad. The plans are required to cover social and economic well-being, the environment, health and economic development. So we shouldn't see Good Food Nation as being something narrow. It is, in fact, very, very broad indeed, and would have as wide coverage as anything that our colleagues in Whitehall are looking to prepare at this stage. In relation to the Agriculture Bill, the committee is obviously aware of the great deal of work that is already underway on that, the work now of the Ariob group to prepare proposals for the future agricultural support system. Similarly, our colleagues in health are working on diet and obesity and measures on promotion. So, you know, this bill does not sit in isolation. There are many of these other developments going on at the same time and will have to be taken into account in the setting of the Good Food Nation Plan, and indeed the Good Food Nation Plan taken into account in those other developments as well.
And so the same would apply for perhaps working alongside the Child Poverty Act?
Yes.
Okay. Well, I've got one more question. What is the definition of a Good Food Nation?
The definition of...
I have read that.
Yes.
So it's very wide.
It is, yes.
But it doesn't take into account what the food is available in terms of the local supply chain. So it's not actually creating... it's not giving local authorities... I've read the parts of the consultations from various local authorities, and they're not happy that there is... they feel there's a lack of clarity, because that description is around three or four sentences long with regards to that definition. So will that definition have the opportunity to be tightened up so that the other aspects of the current definition would be covered in the bill itself?
Okay, I'm not sure on quite what the criticism of the definition of Good Food Nation is. Obviously, the bill itself does not directly define or rely on a definition elsewhere of good food nation. Rather, we've set out the breadth of topics that that the plans are required to include.
Okay, I'll leave it there.
Okay, thank you. Just finally, or I think, Jim, have you got a short supplementary?
Yes, and I may be going over old ground here. In terms of the definition of good food nation that Rachel has just mentioned, I think the best definition that I've ever heard was from James Withers, who said, if we want a good food nation bill, then we have to be a good food nation. So it's changing a cultural thing, but that's just an aside. It's going back to the local authority as opposed to the national government. And I'm taking out of that, and correct me if I'm wrong, that it'll be local authority discretion within the confines of what it is that you're going to give them as a plan to work to. There'll be certain local authorities who get it, who just say, yeah, this is absolutely vital. But there'll be other local authorities who'll be saying, no, we've got to get the building sorted out. So how do we ensure at this stage that local authorities are bought in to the idea of setting up a Good Food Nation plan?
Local authorities individually and through council have been involved throughout the development of the Good Food Nation agenda. I'm sure you're right that there are local authorities that are probably more proactive on this than others. I can certainly think of some that have been very, very active in, for instance, school food and linking school food to local provision. And schemes like Food for Life that we fund is helping local authorities all across the country to do more on that. I think I mentioned earlier that I think that there's room for quite a bit of mutual support and learning in this. So rather than each of the local authorities going away and doing their own thing, but regular sort of comparing of notes, we don't want them all to look exactly the same in terms of their plans, but actually the local authorities that have already put more effort into this can perhaps provide assistance and guidance to others.
So that goes back to what I'm just saying to Rachel, that we're actually creating a culture where this becomes what we want to aspire to. Thank you.
Thank you. Finally, I think we all understand that food and drink and the economy and whatever is a very complex, and health and social care and whatever. One of the responses to the consultation suggested it was too complex an area to be assessed only by KPIs, and there need to be a far broader understanding of how the system's working and how we deliver this cultural change, as Jim has suggested. So how does the Scottish Government intend to oversee how effective public bodies are performing? And indeed, how would the Scottish Government expect to be judged on its performance? Is that through KPIs or how would that be? And will the Scottish Government oversee public bodies? And if they do, does that not suggest we need an independent body to overlook the Scottish Government?
Starting with the end of that question, as I think we've already covered, we're not providing in the bill any scrutiny function for the Scottish ministers in relation to the plans and the reports brought forward by local authorities and other public bodies. That's being left to their own scrutiny mechanisms here. And both
that being then, when you set this out, how did you envisage local authorities in going through that self-assessment process to ensure that they were fulfilling the broad outcomes that are looked for?
So, I mean, local authorities under the bill are required to publish every 2 years their report on the implementation of the plan. Obviously, the members of those local authorities are subject to the electoral cycle and the views of the local electorate, and this might be one of the factors that would be taken into account.
Okay, thank you very much. I don't believe... Oh, Rachel.
So, effectively, you're saying that if they get it wrong, voters can vote them out, but they can't vote Scottish ministers out for bringing forward a bill that is actually doesn't have the ability for local authorities, through the guidance of Scottish ministers, to set targeted policies, implementation plans, success indicators and reporting arrangements.
The local authority and other public bodies are required to have regard to the National Good Food Nation Plan in the setting of their plan. So there is, to that extent, that sort of top-down approach in the setting of the plans. So the local authorities are not entirely free to do as they please.
Well, I don't think that's clear, but I think that's for the committee to discuss a little bit further and dig down into that.
Thanks. And finally, you suggested that local authorities are held to account because of the electoral cycle. How does that apply to health boards?
It probably doesn't in the same way, but I think the question was specifically around local authorities.
So there might be a gap in the legislation regarding how health authorities judge or self-assess their response and to the Good Food Nation plans that they put in place.
I think it might be worth in that looking at other duties that the health bodies have to report on matters. I mean, I don't think that there's any shortage of scrutiny of what health boards are doing and their performance on a whole range of matters, and this would be just another one.
Okay. Well, no further questions, so it just leaves me to thank you very much, Mr Burgess, and your team for coming in and answering our questions. Very much appreciate it. And we now move into private session.